Lord. Amen. What again? A great blessing it is to be here with all you, the people of God. And on this Easter morning, we are certainly so blessed and excited that we get the opportunity to celebrate and be reminded that Jesus is alive. And I don't know about you, but there is a great blessing to know that death does not have the final say. Come on here, somebody, amen. The death doesn't have the final say, but that in many respects, the worst that we may ever think that we are going through, because Jesus got up, it reminds us that we, amen, are never counted out. And so we wanna thank God for all of you that are here in the name of the Lord. We did not have a Good Friday service this year. And so certainly during these next few moments, I certainly hope to even recapture a little bit of what led not only to the death of Jesus, but also why it is so incumbent upon us to be people who are living in light of such a great act of resurrection. So turn with me in your Bibles, if you don't mind. We're going to go to two passages of Scripture. These are our lectionary passages for this season. And we are going to spend a few moments here in Luke chapter number 24, and then we'll go to Colossians chapter number 3. Now, all of these scriptures will be on the screen, so if you are a little challenged to get to and back to those passages as we're reading, then have no fear. We've put them on the screen so you can indeed follow along. But let's be mindful, amen. Last week and for the last few weeks, we've been speaking and preaching through a series called The Sunken Church Syndrome. And we've been talking a lot about this idea that many of us, if not all of us, may have a time in our life where we are in a sunken place. We are in a pit. We are in a bottomless free fall, if you will, because of many of the things that are happening or may happen in our lives. And we have been talking a lot about what does it mean or look like for us to make sure that we don't stay in a place of death and despair and hopelessness. How many know there are many, many of us, many folk we know who can easily get locked into the rut of your life? Amen. I know it's early. Y'all gonna talk back this morning. Amen. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, don't get stuck, don't get stuck, don't get stuck. And we also know that there are always opportunities for us to break out and to get out and to move freely in the power and in the will of God. Well, last week, we saw and left off, Jesus was heading to Jerusalem, and he was on his way to a city, a group of people he knew were ready and conspiring to kill him. They were conspiring to take his life and to turn him over to the authorities of the state because they did not agree with not only his message, but the countercultural way in which he was living and acting. And, you know, it's so fascinating because people, you know, like to just say that Jesus was you know, all about love and you know, he was just, you know, this just lovable character. Amen. But how many know you don't crucify people that, you know, are so lovable? Amen. Jesus certainly was overwhelming with love. And yet at the same time, his love for some folk ended up getting him on a cross. And that's what happened. Jesus found himself betrayed by his closest friends. And he ended up on a cross in front of his mother and in front of his friends. And his whole life in ministry seemed to hang in the balance. There were some who thought Jesus was coming to reenact and to reinstate a new government, a new nation for the oppressed people of his nation and his culture. And Jesus ending up on the cross pretty much put a fork in all of their hopes and their aspirations. And so Jesus hung on a cross for most of the day. On the Friday, it is commonly said, and soon thereafter, a man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea, he was a very wealthy individual. he had a tomb and he had a place where Jesus would be buried. And Joseph, along with some of those who remained, took Jesus' body off the tomb or off the cross, and they buried him in a tomb. And that's kind of where the story left off. It left off with all of these folk who had spent their last few years of their lives forsaking everything to follow Jesus around. Their family thought they were crazy. I'm sure some of them left their jobs, and I'm sure their employers was like, you know, it's a hard economy out here. Amen. I don't think I'm going to be able to hold your job. Amen. Some of them found themselves on the run from authorities and in danger. Their lives were at risk, all because they believed, they dared to believe in this man named Jesus. And so I hope you appreciate and realize the level of despair these disciples were at when they realized that, man, the Roman Empire just killed our master, our leader, some of those who were expecting Jesus to be this political revolutionary that would turn the Roman Empire upside down. All of their hopes had been dashed. And so here we pick up the story of a number of Jesus' followers on the Easter resurrection morning, I believe, showing up in a way of great mourning and great pain and anguish, but they were trying to do right by their crucified leader. And so let's turn our attention to Luke chapter number 24, because we see that as they were coming to the tomb, a few other things happened that they had not anticipated. And I want to suggest to you that Easter and resurrection morning is an opportunity for you to expand your imagination of what is possible when you believe in the resurrected Christ. Let's turn our attention to Luke chapter number 24, verse number 1. The word of God says, "But on the first day of the week at early dawn, they came to the tomb. And they were taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body. And while they were perplexed about this, suddenly two angels or two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. And the women were terrified, bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, 'Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again.'" Verse number 8 says, "Then they remembered his words." Let us also take a quick glance at Colossians chapter number 3. The first few verses of this passage will help tie in with our sermon message for today. Verse number 1 says, "So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to spend a few moments continuing in our series about the sunken church, simply saying that since Jesus got up, you can get out. Amen. If Jesus got up, you can get out. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. Tell your neighbor, since Jesus got up, you can get out. Now, there is something very diabolical about pits and graves. For when you think of a grave, they are usually created to house or to hold that which has been given up for dead. And yet there are rare occasions where pits that are dug up out of the ground, or even grave sites, if you will, are done by the person who will inhabit them. If you think about it for a moment, usually someone who digs the pit is not the one who will end up in the pit. That often, the person digging the pit is digging the pit for someone else. And I don't know about you, but I don't want anybody digging a pit for me. I don't want to be around folk who have an investment in my grave. Amen. I mean, I know, and I encourage y'all to get you some, you know, insurance, you know, life insurance and whatnot. But that's even still a little bit of a different kind of a thing, because they're still banking on you being gone. Touch your neighbor, somebody. There are indeed some realities that even when you get in the pit, how many of you know there are a very few number of people in the world who are willing to go down in that pit with you? I don't know if you've ever been to some of our funerals, amen, and folks are so overwhelmed with grief and it's hard for them to let go, but there always comes a moment when, amen, they close the casket and that person is in that casket all by themselves. I've done a number of funerals at the gravesite, and you start to let the casket into the ground, and I've still yet to see someone jump in there and say, put me in there with them. Because we understand that pits and graves are not for the living. And this is, I think, such an important reality for us here on Easter morning and Resurrection Sunday, because the fact that Jesus gets up out of the pit and out of his grave is a reminder to us that there is a power greater than the graves or pits that we have in our own lives. And even better, there is someone who is greater than the one who dug the pit or the grave for us in the first place. Make no mistake about it, this morning, we are giving ourselves lots of reminders of the proof that as a child of God, as a follower of Jesus, we as committed disciples must always remind ourselves that death is never the final verdict in our lives. And certainly while we may go to the ultimate death, I want to suggest to you that there are always moments in our lives where we feel like we are a dead person walking. I don't know if we're going to be honest this morning on a Sunday morning, but I can't think of a few moments and times in my life where I've had to rely on my conviction that death will not reign supreme in my circumstance, that hopelessness will not take root in my heart. Some call it conviction, others call it confidence. How many of you know we people of God, we call it faith? Amen. That faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things we do not see. And this resurrected Savior named Jesus this morning gives all of us some substance and evidence that can serve as a road map as we go through our pits and our graves. Dare I say, as we go through the season of our sunken places. But how many know if Jesus was able to tap into the power to defeat the ultimate sunken place of death, hell, and the grave? How many of you know that your sunken place is not strong enough to hold you? Hello, somebody. For I found that the gift of resurrection is that we all have within us an awareness of the inevitability that every child of God has access to this same power. This power that will raise us up from our pits and graves, just like Jesus was raised from his. Pat yourself on the chest, remind yourself, Jesus got up. Say that, Jesus got up, so I can get out. Now, many of you know that this last month or so, we've been exploring the tragedy of the church being in a sunken church syndrome. We played a little bit off of this theme that came out of Jordan Peele's movie called Get Out. And some of you may not have done your homework yet and went and seen the movie. Amen. So you better just be ready to get maybe a little bit of a primer. Touch your neighbor, somebody. Amen. But in this film, you had a young brother dating a woman who invited him to come to her house to meet her family. And this woman, you know, he didn't know she was a part of this family that was into like body snatching folk, praise God, amen. And as he was making his journey to this house with body snatchers, he had all kinds of signs along the way that should have warned him, take your tail back home, amen. But how many know he ignored the signs? Yes, he did. And in ignoring the signs, he ended up finding himself surrounded by all kind of folk with all kinds of nefarious intentions. This family turned out to be a real piece of work because in many respects, they had figured out a way to take folks' body by first taking their mind. And this young man was easy prey because he had not yet dealt with his own struggles and issues and challenges. And so because he was in a vulnerable state, unbeknownst to him, this maniacal manipulator was able to tap into his trauma, fear and pain, and put him in such a spell that he was in a free fall, and they called it the sunken place. Now, for many of us, we may not be on our way, I hope, to homes of people who are body snatchers and forming lobotomies and whatnot. But I want to suggest to you that there are many folk in this room today, dare I say, it may even be me and you, who have found ourselves in a place of pre-death, a place where you are not yet in your grave, but you are certainly paralyzed, hypnotized, and immobilized by the circumstances of your life. Your voice is gone. Your mind is clouded, and consequently, you are unable to fulfill your purpose assigned to you by the God of the universe. I want to suggest to you that resurrection morning is specifically for you, because quiet as it's kept, the only way out of the sunken place, the graves of our lives, is to tap into the power that raised Jesus from the dead. Some of us may think that I can get out of this situation by doing all kinds of self-help, and I can just, you know, click my heels and wish upon a star. I can just work harder and my life will turn around. But how many of you know that there are some moments in your life where all your hard work will get you further in your place of despair? Do I have any honest folk in the house that would say that even all of my efforts to turn my life around, to change the worst circumstances in my community, seems to fall short and leave me feeling worse than I was before I embarked on this journey? I want to submit to you that we have someone in the name of Jesus who was able to go through the different ups and downs of his life and even hit the lowest point and still figure out a way to make it out with not only more power, but with a greater testimony that is still transforming and changing anyone who will listen some thousands of years later. I want you to know today that this is the story of resurrection, and it is the story of our salvation that has been left for us. And I want you to know that if you and I will get out of our situations, it will be because we've tapped into the power that allowed Jesus to get up from his. So what must we do? What must we do? The first thing that I love about this story and this passage is that in order for you and I to get past our places of despair, dare I say, our sunken place, we have to first lean into the confrontation of what has caused us to end up there in the first place. Somebody holler confrontation. Now, it is clear that in the mind and the eyes of everyone who was around, Jesus had lost. I mean, Jesus was walking around with all these grandiose claims of who he was and what he would do, and he still ended up where everybody else who made the same claims ended up. You know, Jesus was not the first one to come on the scene and talk about all the things that he was going to do. Just like you have folk in your life that kind of come in and out of your life, talking about all the great things that they're going to do. Anybody ever had some folk in your life that talk big but delivered nothing? I can't talk too honest to y'all. I know it's early in the morning. Amen. But anybody ever had somebody who was able to make big promises, but at the end, all they had were a bunch of excuses? Well, what had happened was, how many know it's a terrible thing to build your life on some broken promises? It's a terrible thing to live your life off of what you heard someone tell you only to find out at the end that they were just as shady and unreliable as the next person. I mean, when you look in our political environment today, it's so fascinating because we have all these folk who are now seeing that much of what, if not everything, that the elected president number 45 said he would do, he's not doing. Just yesterday, folks were out in the streets in large numbers because they were trying to say, you should release your tax returns like you promised you would. But I didn't go out there to protest that, because I knew in my heart that this man ain't serious about keeping not one promise he made. But there's some folk who are crushed. Oh, my God. Mr. Trump didn't keep his word. Trying to figure out. It's a terrible thing to build your life on someone who is unreliable. And some of us end up in some sunken places because we are allowing the unreliable promises and words of people around us,
or we are allowing our circumstances and situations, which are indeed filled with trauma, anger, and fear, to overdetermine our lives. And what I love about this story is that in order for the people who were the followers of Jesus to experience resurrection, they had to first confront their worst reality: the tomb where Jesus was supposed to be laying. The tomb represents the pit, the grave, the sunken place in our life where many of us are afraid to confront. We'd rather deal with everything else. Dare I say, we'd rather deal with everybody else. Ain't it something that it's so much easier to notice all the idiosyncrasies of the person next to you? But when it comes into your own life, amen, it's hard for you to understand why anyone would even speak on your life. Mm-hmm. When in reality, it's because your life is a total mess. Hello, somebody. And it's obvious, you know, anyone ever got dressed up in the dark, amen, you was trying, I do this often because, you know, I leave early in the morning, I don't be wanting to wake up my wife or the kids, so sometimes I only turn the bathroom light on because it kind of shine in my room, and I be trying to find two matching socks. Or I be looking in the mirror and thinking that I got the right tone of blues on or the right tones of black on, and, you know, I'm thinking I'm matching, and then you get out into the lights. You may not even pay attention to yourself, but then you just notice people looking at you as you're walking by, like. Then finally someone that really likes you, cares about you, be like, yo, man, like you know, you're not, you missed it this morning. I shave my head and sometimes I have a blotch of hair just on the back of my head. And Charisse is probably the only one in the world that will kindly, with joy, tell me, Michael, you got a patch. Realizing that it's hard for some of us to come to grips with that which leads us into places of despair and hopelessness. But I love how these disciples woke up early in the morning while it was still dark. And they had the courage to confront their tomb. I wonder, child of God, do you have the courage to confront that which keeps leading you into a sunken place? Do you and I have the courage to take the necessary steps to ensure that we are not falling into the pits and the graves that others are digging for us, or dare I say, sometimes we contribute to ourselves because we won't have the courage to confront those things or places in our lives. I want to submit that there are a lot of triggers and there are a lot of things that if you don't confront, those things will continue to have power over us. If you don't confront your biases, if you don't confront your trauma, if you don't confront your addictions, if you don't confront your issues and your challenges, it matters not what happens around you, because certain things will trigger you and you'll find yourself being paralyzed and immobilized and distracted from experiencing the fullness of God's resurrecting power. So one of the first things I want to lift to you this morning is, who have you given the power to build graves and pits that end up with you falling inside? How must you show up to the tombs of your life, if you will, to take those powers back from that person, that place, that experience, that thing? Are you able to diagnose these triggers, or are you so susceptible to what's happening around you that you can't imagine that the courage necessary to confront these moments and seasons in your life continues to evade you? My child of God, my loved one, I want to suggest to you this morning that the only way you can even get to experience resurrection is that you have to first have the courage to confront those things in your life that drive you towards death. I got to move quickly, amen. The second thing that I want you to lift up or be aware of is that if you're going to experience resurrection, the kind of resurrection that got Jesus up, you have to also get your mind back. Somebody holler, get your mind back, get your mind back. If we go to Colossians verse number 3, it says, Colossians chapter number 3, verse 2, it says, set your mind on things above. One of the great challenges of many of us is that our minds are so hypnotized and captivated by our pain and our disappointments. Or we are so preoccupied with all that's going wrong around us that we forget that your mind is supposed to have a different level of altitude. It is not to mean that you become someone, as the old folk used to say, that you're so heavenly minded that you know earthly good. Amen. I'm not telling you to be one of those escapism Christians. But I am telling you that there is a way your mind can be so above, set above to those things, focused on the right thing, that even when the terrible things happen, you are able to keep the right perspective and the right focus on the one who has the power to bring about resurrection. I mean, if you think about why the disciples were so filled with despair, naturally, it's because they were seeing things from the below position. I mean, in their mind, Jesus had just been eliminated by their enemy. Jesus had just been crucified. He had just been executed. Jesus was Michael Brown. Jesus was Tamir Rice. Jesus was Alex Nieto. Jesus was Sandra Bland. Jesus was Renisha McBride. Jesus was all these folk who'd been killed by the state with no consequence. And just like them, I can imagine a few of them are ready to tear some stuff up, to shut a few streets down. But I am so captivated that Jesus, going through the same experience, found himself able to be focused in a different way, where he said, no one can take my life because I'm laying it down. Are you catching this? The disciples experiencing the same experience, but from a below point of view, are watching their Savior be crucified. But Jesus, experiencing the same thing from a set above point of view, was saying that no one can take from me because I'm laying it down. What are you trying to say, Pastor Mike? That if your mind is free from the entanglements of this world, you can go through the same thing everybody else is going through, but you will have a totally different understanding and take about what God is up to. Hallelujah. And this is why you and I have to make sure we set our mind on things above. Because you and I can get so caught up with what's happening around us that we will get discouraged and we will be left to despair. But how many of you know, if you serve the one who was risen from the grave, there is no worse thing that the enemy can do to you but to take your life. But if God has the power to raise you up again, then even the devil's best shot is still not good enough for the God of the resurrected people. And so this means a couple of things, dear loved ones. It means that you and I gotta make sure we get our mind free. There are lots of things in this moment in time that will hypnotize us. In the movie, all she had to do was click a teacup, and all of a sudden, sunk in place. What is your teacup? What is the thing that happens in your life, that trigger that someone can click? Is it a Trump press conference? Is it the boss on your job? Is it the despair of the deaths and the trafficking and the poverty in our communities? Is it your own anger, fear, and pain that can pull your mind from above down to below? Whatever it is that will keep you from having your mind set above. It's time for some of us to turn loose some things. Don't mean you ignore it. Lord knows, y'all know what I do. I don't ignore none of it. But my heart and my mind and my soul are directly connected to the possibility of the resurrected Jesus. So when you go out into the neighborhood, when you go into the schools to teach, when you go home to your relationships or your families, when you go on your job, when you're in the hospital, when you're at your lowest moment or your highest point, your life should always be connected to the resurrected one who can help you and I move beyond the limitations of the graves and the pits that are in our lives. So what's another set of questions that you want to think about today? Have you been hypnotized to a point where you are paralyzed? Some of us got to be honest, because, you know, we good at lying to ourselves and everybody around us. But how many know when you're paralyzed, it's obvious to everybody that you can't move? What situation paralyzes you and keeps you from moving in your purpose? Moving in the power of resurrection. I mean, the second part of this, what must you do to free your mind so you can be focused on your highest call? Not keep messing around down there in the desert of despair, in the wilderness of hopelessness. As a follower of Jesus, child of God, you have access and opportunity to not being limited to the worst things that happen in your life. And finally, the last thing that I think you and I should consider is not only that Jesus got up, but he got up so you and I can get out. I love in this passage how the angel asked those who were there looking for Jesus, which lets me know that you can be looking for Jesus in all the wrong places. The angel asked them, why are you looking for the living among the dead? Some of us are looking for life in dead places. And the only way that you can experience resurrection is if you actually start to make sure that you are searching and finding the places where God's resurrecting power is at work. Some say, oh, God can work anywhere. Of course God can work anywhere. But the question is, will you work anywhere? Man, because God ain't limited by no time and place, but some of us definitely are. And remember, God found you in a club, amen. God found you high. God found you doing all kind of nefarious things. And God sobered you up real quick. How many, there's some trouble in your life that God could allow to happen that will make your eyes stand wide open and be like, oh, that's what you were talking about. I want you to understand that if God had the power to raise Jesus from the dead, then God has the power to get you out of your situations as well. And you may have some circumstances that you think are so deep and desolate. But I love the psalmist that says that God drew me up out of my pits. He drew me out of my miry clay, and he set my feet on a rock, and he made my steps secure. I'm here to tell you today that if there's one thing resurrection provides for you and I, is that we are now on solid footing. You and I no longer have to go through life in a free fall, no matter what part of your life you're in. God says that if you are resurrected with me, now your life has become stabilized. Why? Because I will not allow my children to be in a situation where they don't have any help. Lord, help me today, because there's nothing worse than feeling like you have no help. There's nothing worse than feeling like you are isolated and all alone and left to the whimsical nature of your situation. But I believe the word of God where it says that I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and he heard my cry. 2 Corinthians, it says it like this, that if you only look at me, you might miss the brightness of the gift of God that lives inside of me. He says that we've been surrounded and battered by troubles, but we're not demoralized. We're not sure what to do, but we know that God knows what to do. We've been spiritually terrorized, but God hasn't left our side. We've been thrown down, but we have not been broken, because what they did to Jesus, they do to us. They put us through trials and tribulations. They torture and make a mockery of who we are. They lie on my name, and they think that they can kill our bodies. They can crush our spirit. They can throw us in jails. They can start wars and rumors of wars. But I'm so glad that what Jesus did in the middle of all of that stuff, he's given you and me the power to do as well. That even though I may feel like I'm dead, I have the confidence that one day I will rise again. You ought to give your neighbor a quick high five and tell him, I'm getting ready to rise again. I may not look like much this morning. I may not look like I have it all together. But this one thing I know, that I will not stay in a sunken place when God has called me to rise from the dead. I will not stay in my depression when God has called me to rise from the dead. I will not stay in my hopelessness when God has called me to rise from my situation. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Thanks be to God who gives us the victory. So I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, or things to come, shall be able to separate me from the love of God. Jesus got up so you can get out. So get out of your challenge. Get out of your trial. Get out of your hopelessness. Get out of your stupor. It's time to get up and get out. Give your neighbor one more high five and tell him, get up. Get out. Tell him again, get up. Get out. Don't you stay there. Don't you sit there. But get up. And get out. Come on, stand with me, everybody, real quick, real quick. Why do we sit here and die when God has already given us the opportunity to live? I will live and proclaim the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Resurrection Sunday affords you and I another opportunity to tap into a truth that life is within your grasp. New life. Somebody say new life.
New life.
That means the life you live in today is not the best life you can be living. Some of you are already followers of Jesus. You still need to say it again. New life. That the life you're living today is not the best life that you can have. Because we follow the resurrected Savior, new life. That is a result of the resurrected Savior can bring us to higher heights, elevated and freed minds, renewed spirits, do the work and the will of God. Grab the hand of someone next to you.